morning, everyone. Happy Easter. And the choir do a great job. I tried to join the choir, and they said something about, you can do announcements, something about comic relief or something like that. I'm just kidding, just messing with it. I don't want to take the focus off Christ and where it needs to be today, but we do have a few orders of business we want to discuss. So first of all, if you can grab your bulletins, take them out, and you'll find a connection card in there. If you've been with us before, all we ask is if your information hasn't changed, just put your name on the top, put it in the baskets as you leave today or in the bin at the back. But if you've never been with us here, we invite you to fill out that whole card. Look for the check boxes especially. If you're interested in any information about our church, you can check there. You can ask questions on there. I especially want to highlight, if you're looking for ways to get involved, we'd love to have you. We have a lot of small groups going on. There's Bible studies. We have a Get Fit group. We have a men's basketball. If you're just looking for fellowship or if you're looking to go deeper in your faith, there's many ways to engage there as well. Also, speaking of events and ways to get involved, we have a women's brunch coming up on Saturday, April 30th at 10 a.m. So that's for children to adults. If you're a lady, you're invited. They just ask that you sign up in the lobby as a way to let them know how much food to prepare for. And then also, we have on next Saturday, we're going to have a work day. And, you know, it doesn't matter. We'd love to have all of you. Misery and joy's company, right? Seriously, some of my favorite memories is doing some jobs that you just wouldn't normally do, some nasty jobs with some people when you didn't plan it. And I don't know if we have anything that nasty, or I'm sure we could come up with something if you want, but we'd love to have you come out and help us just do some spring cleaning, get things ready, in with the old, or out with the old, in with some of the new, and love to have you for that. If you purchase a Easter lily, if you want to, you can take those. You can take those home even after the service. If you're not planning on sticking around for the second service, take those home. And then, if you are sticking around for the second service afterwards, we could use some help even today, taking down the gym and resetting it for our ministries throughout the week. So, that's it for our announcements. At this time, it's time to get into God's word. It's time to remember what Christ has done for us, and it's time to worship our risen Savior. So let's stand for today's call to worship, led by Colleen Ladd.
He is risen!
He is risen indeed!
Oh, yes. Today's call to worship is from Psalm 68. I will read the leader text. If you would please respond by reading the all text. May God arise. May his enemies be scattered. May his foes flee before him.
May he roll them away like smoke, as wax melts before the fire. May the wicked perish before God.
But may the righteous be glad and rejoice before God. May they be happy and joyful.
Sing to God. Sing in praise of his name. Extol him.
A father to the fatherless, a defender of widows, is God in his holy dwelling.
Our God is a God who saves. From the sovereign Lord comes the saving from death. Praise be to God.
Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for what this day means. Lord, this day is a celebration of the fact that sin has been defeated, death has been defeated, and there is newness of life and a resurrection to come, and now because of what Jesus did for us. Lord, we pray that you would take this service, receive it as a gift from us as we open our hearts up and adore you and love you, worship you for all of your worth this morning. Lord, help us to do that in spirit and in truth, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. If you have a Bible with you, I would encourage you to open it up to Daniel chapter 12. Yes, we are going to the Old Testament because the Old Testament points to what happens in the New Testament and the New Covenant. And at this time, Pastor Keith is going to come forward and lead us in the reading of Daniel 12, verses 1 through 4.
Daniel chapter 12, verses 1 through 4. At that time, Michael, the great prince who protects your people, will arise. There will be a time of distress such as not happened from the beginning of nations until then. But at that time, your people, everyone whose name is found written in the book, will be delivered. Multitudes who sleep in the dust of the earth will awake, some to everlasting life, others to shame and everlasting contempt. Those who are wise will shine like the brightness of the heavens, and those who lead many to righteousness like the stars forever and ever. But you, Daniel, roll up and seal the words of the scroll until the time of the end. Many will go here and there to increase in knowledge. This is God's word. You may be seated.
Thank you for standing out of respect for the reading of God's word. And just so you know, this church finds God's words authoritative. That's why we stand for it, to give it reverence and honor, because what God has said is true. And because it's true, and because of what we just read this, we're going to look at this later. There's a truth in this thing called resurrection. We're going to look at the implications of later, folks, because I believe if you believe the resurrection, in the final analysis, nothing bad can ever happen to you, because you know one day you will live beyond whatever that bad thing is. We're going to spend some time transitioning into worship and giving at this time. We have a special music by David Youngman. And we're going to receive an offering by, if you want, you can place tithes and offerings in the baskets that are in your pew. You can also place them in the boxes at the back of the sanctuary when you leave later. But as we hear this song and receive this offering, reflect on the words of this song and its meaning, that Christ is, in fact, risen. And that means a whole new world of things for us. Let's pray and bless this offering. Father, we thank you for the fact that you are risen, Lord. And because of that, we have a resurrection to look forward to. Because of what you did on the cross, Lord, you died in our place, but you didn't stay dead, Lord. You rose victorious over the grave. Lord, may the truth of the resurrection profoundly impact our hearts and lives today as we look to it, look at it, and consider what it has for, what it means for us as your followers, Father. We praise you and thank you. Bless this offering. Lord, use it as a means of which we can not just come and see, taste and see that the Lord is good, but go and tell the goodness of our God in Christ Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. join our voices in song to celebrate the risen Lord. It's easier for us to switch. Okay. Christ the Lord is risen today. That's good. We're with you, okay?
resurrection narrative, I like to bounce around in the Gospels because there's different, each Gospel writer brings a different take on what's going on in the resurrection, bringing their own nuance to it, their own side of the story, but yet they're all inspired by God. So they're all useful, right? As all Scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, correcting, and training, right, and rebuking in righteousness, so that can equip us. And there is implications to this one as well. And so I would encourage you, open up to Mark chapter 16. We're going to be looking at verses 1 through 8. Before we dive into the message, I like to kind of open with a question to get your minds thinking and probing and wondering about things. And I guess the question I want to start off with today is, what is your favorite movie? Lord of the Rings. What? Harry Potter. What? Les Mis. Ooh, that's a good one. Sound of Music. Fiddler on the Roof? That one. Gone with the Wind. Ooh, we got some classics. I have two movies that always compete for the affections of my heart. Star Wars, like the good ones, the 4, 5, and 6. I just made a lot of enemies. And The Princess Bride. Both movies that are just... You know, what's fascinating about a great movie, a good movie, a great movie elicits certain feelings in you. If you have a favorite movie, it elicits certain feelings in you time and time again. There are movies like those two for me, especially. It doesn't matter how many times I watch them. I get to a part in the movie, and I start to feel something, right? In Star Wars, it's when the mask comes off Anakin, Darth Vader, and it's revealed that, Luke, I am your father. I'm like, no, again, I've seen this a million times. Every single time there's that anticipation, right? Right? Or in The Princess Bride, it's always when the priest or the pope, whatever, the guy with the hat says, you know, he's forced by Prince Humperdinck to say man and wife, you know? And you're left wondering, is it too late for Wesley to rescue the princess? That's a good movie. It doesn't matter how many times I see it, that sense sort of wells up inside of me. Once again, folks, and Holy Week kind of does that to us. If we're believers, if we're followers in Jesus, we get to Good Friday. Good Friday is an irony. Maybe it's not for you, but it is for me, because every time I leave Good Friday, I leave feeling, man, this last Good Friday, and it's like we're at Christ Chapel, and it's raining, it's dreary. I mean, I don't know. I walk into that service, and man, I'm like, because Good Friday meant someone was dying. And that someone's dying meant something else for us. But unlike any movie, unlike any story that's ever been told, what we're here to celebrate today is not fantasy. It really did happen. The matter of the resurrection is a matter of historical fact. In fact, Josh McDowell. In his book, More Than a Carpenter, he said the truth of the resurrection out of the realm of fantasy and places it in the realm of history. It's something you have to understand. And if you're one of those that believes what we're about to read that took place, and it's something you not only believe but confess, as it says in Romans 10:9-10, chances are you too will one day see a resurrection yourself. And so at this time, Tony's going to come forward and lead us in the reading of our text this morning, Mark 16, 1 through 8. If you're able and can, would you stand out of respect for the reading of God's word this morning?
Mark 16, 1 through 8. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so they might go to anoint Jesus' body. Very early, on the first day of the week, just after sunrise, they were on their way to the tomb, and they asked each other, "Who will roll the stone away from the entrance of the tomb?" But when they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had been rolled away. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. "Don't be alarmed," he said. "You're looking for Jesus the Nazarene who was crucified. He has risen. He's not here. See the place where they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter, he is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you. Trembling and bewildered, the women went out and fled from the tomb. They said nothing to anyone because they were afraid. This is God's word. You may be seated.
That I think will be helpful to you. Sorry about that. And you know, there is so much going on in the resurrection narrative, because again, friends, what you just heard was a matter of historical fact, not fantasy. The historical evidence for the resurrection is arguably exhaustive. And I have that quote from Josh McDowell. He says, "The resurrection takes the question, is Christianity valid, out of the realm of philosophy and makes it a question of history." Why? Well, because the Bible says that the resurrection was a thing that did happen. You have to account for some things. You have to account for the post-resurrection eyewitnesses. Upwards of 500 people saw Jesus alive after he was risen. You have to account for the utter transformation of a bunch of men who just 2 days earlier were in hiding and cowering, yet were transformed and would go to their death based on their belief that this was a fact, a thing that did in fact happen. You have to account for the women whose testimony would have been invalid in a court of law at that time. Why would they use women to give this evidence? Well, because it probably did happen. They'd only be crazy to count on women in that day, because their admission, their testimony was inadmissible in court. You have to account for Jesus' siblings. How many of you got a brother or sister? How many of you know they ain't Jesus? Yeah, me too. Yet Jesus' own siblings would go to their death believing, James, his brother, would go to his death believing on the basis of the resurrection being a fact. You have to account for all the numerous non-Christian writers who give testimony in some way, shape, or form that what had happened indeed happened, but transformed these people. People like Tacitus, Suetonius, Mara Bar Serapion, Josephus, you've heard of some of these names before. And folks, you got to account for the empty tomb, because if the resurrection didn't happen, produce the body. And I could go on, and I've shared that Easter message before here, you know, looking at the evidence for all of this stuff. And I got to be honest with you, when I was preparing this message for this particular Easter Sunday, it was a little bit of a struggle. You know, because as I'm preparing this message, you know, I keep thinking to myself, what in the world am I going to say that hasn't already been said like a million times before? In fact, Tuesdays are my Sabbath. I take time off and spend with Jesus, essentially. And last Tuesday, Jesus and I were in the woods hiking, enjoying the weather that day. And I'm telling Jesus, what in the world am I going to say that people in this room haven't heard a million times before? And you know, and I'm not gonna claim to make some claim that Jesus handed me like a golden sermon outline or something like that. But I will say this, that you know, I was in a moment there just praying and walking, hiking with my dog, and I got this distinct impression that there's nothing new that really needs to be said. The truth of the resurrection is incredibly powerful in and of itself. You know, it's a beautiful truth, because not only did it really happen, it really transforms lives. And so the question I want to ask today is this, the question I was asking myself earlier this week: what could possibly be said about the resurrection that hasn't already been said 1,000 times before? The answer, not much. That's okay. Because if I did say something new, it probably wouldn't be orthodox anyways. But folks, I believe our need to hear its truth and be renewed by its hope never, never ceases. We live in a world that's pregnant with brokenness, hopelessness. If you've ever felt that angst in your stomach, that something just ain't right here. Philip Yancey, in his book, The Jesus I Never Knew, wrote, "Something primal in human beings cries out against the reign of death." But friends, while this world and this life are often pregnant with brokenness and hopelessness, folks, the resurrection delivers hope that can get you through it, arguably all the way to the other side. So let's look at that. What's so awesome and amazing about the resurrection? First, how it makes clear Christ's defeat of death by his own submission to it. We need to remember something this morning, folks. When Jesus died on the cross, it was no mere man dying. One of my favorite movies, another one of my favorite movies, Lord of the Rings, there's a scene in Return of the King where Eowyn is about to face this witch, the Witch King, essentially, is going to come down and kill her, although he doesn't know that it's a her, but because she's in the full, you know, armor and everything, and he gets a huge, no mere man can kill me. She whips off her helmet, and she says, I am no mere man. Anybody ever seen that part? I am no man. And she kills the Witch King, right? Jesus was no mere man dying on that cross. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The author of life himself submitted himself to death, and by doing so, broke its power. St. Athanasius on the Incarnation, a work he wrote in the 4th century, says this, He, the life of all, our Lord and Savior, did not arrange the manner of his own death, lest he should seem to be afraid of some other kind. No! He accepted and bore upon the cross a death inflicted by others and those other his special enemies, a death which to them was supremely terrible and by no means to be faced. And he did this in order that by destroying even this death, he might himself be believed to be the life and the power of death be recognized as finally annulled. A marvelous and mighty paradox has thus occurred, for the death which they thought to inflict on him, its dishonor and disgrace, has become the glorious monument to death's defeat. Christ's defeat of death was secured by him submitting to it because he was no mere man. He was God in the flesh dying on that cross. Secondly, how by Christ's death, sin and its grip are utterly defeated. Folks, when Christ died on that cross, he not only defeated death, but he defeated the root cause of death, namely sin, along with the burden of guilt and shame that comes with it. Christ took on himself the sin of all who trusted him as their substitute. Christ paid the fine on the cross that you and I racked up. He paid the debt you and I have been racking up since we were born as sinners, and he paid that fine because he loved us, and his death as our substitute atoned for our sin and it makes atonement for our sins when we place our trust and faith in him alone to save us. Sin and its grip are utterly defeated. Folks, I have good news. If you are in Christ, a part of you is already dead. Romans 6:6, for we know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body ruled by sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin. And not just that, we've been freed from it because the next verse, because anyone who has died has been set free from sin. That's an amazing truth, folks. Sin and its grip are ultimately defeated. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Why? Because that sin's been paid for. Thirdly, how it confirms the reality of the resurrected life now and yet to come. The now, not yet. The resurrection we get to experience now, but we also get to experience in the future. When we believe in Jesus, we have a resurrected life to look forward to post-mortem. But we also have a life to live, a resurrected, a new life to live into pre-mortem. Not a term you hear so often. And folks, it's a tragedy when people get saved and proceed to park their rear ends in the pew for the rest of their life, failing to live into the potential of what Jesus has for them in living through them. We have a resurrection to look forward to. We have a resurrection to live into. We get to do that because of Jesus. And I realize some of us can't wait to get to heaven. Right? The trajectory of the world, the brokenness, and my annual increase in age are turning my gaze there as well. But friends, I'm here to tell you that if you have turned to faith and to Christ in faith to forgive you of your sin, you are already living in eternity. Your eternity is now as well. Yes, you're still attached to your mortal body, but your eternity is already a reality. What you make of the current reality in light of Christ's resurrection impacts your future one. Matthew 6:19 talks about Jesus rising from the dead as the first fruits. He was the first fruits of all those who would rise again. John 5:24, very truly I tell you, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be judged, but has already crossed over from death to life. Philippians 3, our citizenship is in heaven and we eagerly await a Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ, who by the power that enables him to bring everything under his control will transform our lowly bodies so they will be like his glorious body. Lastly, how its truth empowers and enables Christ's resurrected ones to live. Adrian Warnock, in his book, Raised with Christ, writes this. He says, Christians have therefore already been changed by Jesus' resurrection. Jesus really is alive today. He lives, Christ Jesus. I know that he lives inside of me. There's a resurrection that's already taken place in our hearts if we're trusting in Christ. Jesus really is alive today. Because of this, Christians are also alive in a whole new way, Adrian goes on. The same power that raised Christ from the dead is living in every true Christian. The truth of the resurrection impacts how we live now, and we can live in a very strange new way with confidence, boldness, and assurance in light of what Jesus has done for us, not on our own merits, but because of his love and his power to conquer sin. When you know how the story ends and you are convinced that its ending is good, you don't live in fear or fright so much. You know, after 20 years of watching The Lord of the Rings, speaking of Lord of the Rings, after 20, whenever long ago that came out, like, I'm no longer surprised that the ring makes it to the Mordor. Like, that doesn't surprise me anymore. It's not like I'm sitting out there wondering if Frodo's going to make it. Why? Because I know how the story ends. Folks, we know how the story ends. And we can live in an empowered and emboldened way in light of that. And we don't have to worry what's going on in the world around us. We don't have to worry about what's going on in Washington, folks, because we know who is risen, we know who is king, and we know how this ends. Jesus wins. The Apostle Paul in Romans 8:18, I consider that our present sufferings, they're not worth comparing to the glory that will be revealed in us. Later on in Galatians, he also writes in chapter 2, I've been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in my body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. So in conclusion, how should we respond in light of the resurrection? What's our response to this? And this is really simple, folks. Because I looked at this text, I was studying this text and thinking about it, meditating on it. And the angel that Matthew identifies this as an angel in his gospel in verse 6 here, he says, don't be afraid. You're looking for Jesus of Nazareth who was crucified. He is risen. He is not here. Come and see the place where they laid him. And I think that's something for us too. We need to come and see that Jesus is risen. Jesus is risen and sin and death have been defeated, folks. Jesus is risen and there is no longer need for us to worry about anything. Jesus is risen and guilt has lost its grip. Jesus is risen and sickness does not have the final say in your existence. Jesus is risen and there's hope for those you love. Jesus is risen and there's that addiction you are fighting does not get the last word in your life. Jesus is risen and the shackles of your past trauma have been unlocked. Jesus is risen and although it may seem like the world is going to pot, the final chapter has been written, and spoiler alert, Jesus wins. Jesus is risen, and if you are trusting in him, one day you will rise too. Frederick Buechner, a really great quote about this, he says, resurrection means that the worst thing is never the last thing. the cross wasn't the end of the story. Because Sunday was coming. And there would be a resurrection. A first fruits of all those who would subsequently rise because of their faith and trust in the Messiah that came to save. Do you need a resurrection? Come to Jesus. He'll give you one. Trust him. Look to him. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Psalm 34 says, blessed is the one who takes refuge in him. So not only come and see, but the angel gave a second set of instructions. Go and tell. Go tell his disciples. And Peter, he's going ahead of you into Galilee. Go and tell. And if you've come to Christ and you've tasted and have seen that the Lord is good, just like the women at the tomb, the next thing, go and tell. Paul Menier wrote this. He said this once, God does not disclose the resurrection fact except to enlist people in a task. I love that. Chuck Colson, that name might sound a little bit more familiar to this group, said this once, you are called to be successful. You are not called to be successful or to meet any other counterfeit standards of this world, but to be faithful, to be expended in the cause of serving the risen and returning Christ. We get to be a part of this mission to bring this resurrection hope to the world. Because as it says in Romans 10:10-15, for it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, and it's with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved. As Scripture says, anyone who believes in him will never be put to shame. For there is no difference between Jew and Gentile. The same Lord is Lord of all and richly blesses all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. How then can they call on the one they've not believed in? And how can they believe in the one whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them? And how can anyone preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news, folks. And that's my challenge to you today. You may be here and you are not trusting in Jesus Christ. You need to come and see that he is good, that he can save you. People here that have, though, have you seen that, you've tasted that, you believe, now you need to, just like the angel says, go and tell. And even just as Jesus would say later on in this chapter, go into all the world and preach the good news to all creation. My gospel application is this. There is no gospel without the resurrection. It's as plain as that, folks. The hope of eternity rests in the fact that Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ is coming again. Praise be to God. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for your goodness, your graciousness to us in Christ Jesus, who being very nature you, didn't consider equality with you something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, humbled himself, made himself nothing, put on flesh, as we read in John 1, and didn't just do that, but he lived a perfect life for us because he knew we couldn't do it. And then he submitted himself to death, even death on a cross. One of the worst ways imaginable to die, Lord, so that in him, when we put our faith and trust, we can have your righteousness. God, what an amazing gift. Thank you so much for what you've done, not only by dying, but in rising, Lord, because we now know that in the final analysis, everything bad will be made untrue because of Jesus. Thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Before we stand for a benediction, just a word of instruction. If you're staying for the brunch, we'll just have you make your way to the gym and find a seat at the table. We'd love for you to join us for brunch this morning. You can probably smell it, and if you haven't noticed, like, I've had a lot of spit coming out of my mouth. But feel free to have a seat at the table until we get instructions that it's okay to proceed through the line. And let's celebrate our Lord and Savior. Sticking around for second service, we'll be back in here at 10:50. Very different service if you're sticking around for it. Message will be similar. But a different service in a lot of other regards. You're welcome to stay for both and celebrate. But let's stand and receive the benediction. Now may the risen Lord Jesus cause in your heart to stir a newness of life, a longing for a future resurrection and a realization of your current resurrected state in Christ. May he be with you, give you peace, and give you power to live boldly in light of the fact that Christ is risen. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen, folks. Have a wonderful week in the Lord. Take care.